Hello friends, from this video we are going to learn the history of Six Sigma and continuous improvements as well as the contribution of quality gurus in this journey. This video is the first part of this learning. We'll explain the history of Six Sigma and continuous improvements. So let's begin. History of Six Sigma. The concept of Six Sigma was developed in 1987 by Motorola. Six Sigma is basically a packaging of lot of quality tools. These quality tools were developed much before 1987. It is more of an evolutionary development in the science of continuous improvement that combines the best elements from many earlier quality initiatives. Although some of the tools used in Six Sigma, such as quality function deployment, that is QFD, are relatively new, many of the tools such as fishbone diagram are older than 50 years. The philosophies related to Six Sigma have existed from 1798, as seen in the figure. As we know, customer focus, data-driven decision-making, business results focus, and process understanding are not new approaches to the business success. What is new and what makes Six Sigma so powerful is the combination of these elements with a rigorous, disciplined approach and well-publicized, proven business successes. As per the quote of George Santayana, those who do not learn from the history are doomed to repeat them. This is also true in the field of quality and continuous improvements. Understanding the roots of quality and the reasons behind the methods will allow practitioners to launch successful projects or large-scale initiatives. Evolution of Six Sigma. The roots of Six Sigma as a measurement standard can be traced back to Carl Friedrich Gauss, who introduced the concept of normal curve. Six Sigma as a measurement standard in product variation can be traced back to 1920s when Walter Schwarz showed that 3 sigma from the mean is the point where a process requires correction. Many measurement standards such as CPK, zero defect, etc., etc., later came on the scene, but credit for coining the term Six Sigma goes to the Motorola engineer named Bill Smith. In the early and mid 1980s, with Chairman Bob Galvin at helm, Motorola engineers decided that the traditional quality levels, that is, measuring defects in thousands of opportunities, didn't provide enough granularity. Instead, they wanted to measure the defects per million opportunities. Motorola developed this new standard and methodology, as well as the needed cultural change associated with it. There was a significant result in bottom line of Motorola by the use of Six Sigma. In fact, they documented more than $16 billion savings as a result of their Six Sigma efforts. Since then, tens of thousands of companies around the world, including but not limited to Allied Signal, GE, DuPont, Ford, GM, Cummins, Wipro, HDFC, etc., etc., have adopted Six Sigma as a way of doing business. Six Sigma has evolved over time. It's more than just a quality system like TQM or ISO. It's a way of doing business. History of continuous improvements. 1798, Eli Whitney, mass production and interchangeable parts. Best known for his invention of the cotton gin in 1787, Eli Whitney had a greater impact on modern manufacturing with the introduction of his revolutionary uniformity system. In 1798, Whitney was awarded a government contract to produce 10,000 muskets. He proved that it was possible to produce interchangeable parts that were similar enough in fit and function to allow the random selection of parts in the assembly of muskets. Throughout the next century, quality involved defining ways to objectively verify the new parts would match the original parts or design. Exact replication was not always necessary, practical, cost-effective, or measurable. In the mid-1800s, the objective methods of measuring and assuring dimensional consistency were evolved. This was due to the introduction and use of Go gauges that verified the minimum dimension of the new part. The correct replication of the maximum dimension was assured by using the no-go gauges that were introduced about 30 years later. Minimum and maximum tolerance limits as measured by the use of these gauges provided some of the first objective measures of similarity among parts. These measures eventually evolved into specifications. 1913, Henry Ford and the moving assembly line. With the introduction of Henry Ford's moving automobile assembly line in 1913, the need for predetermined part consistency becomes more critical. It was critical that only good parts be available for use so that production assembly line would not be forced to slow down or stop while a worker sorted the good parts. With the Industrial Revolution in full swing, ever-increasing production volumes required different methods of testing and assurance to provide reasonable certainty the new product would be similar to the original product or design. It was no longer practical to test each piece against go and no-go gauges. Such testing was expensive, unacceptably time-consuming, and in some cases impossible. Therefore, methods to monitor the consistency of the process that produced the parts and the use of sampling rather than 100% inspection were becoming necessities. Due to time constraint, we will be continuing the learning of history of continuous improvements and the contribution of quality gurus in it in the next video. For references, I have taken some part of this very detailed content from ASQ and I Six Sigma. Now to end, please like this video if you have found it useful, add your valuable comments and share this video to your friends and colleagues to improve and refresh their knowledge. If you want to get updates of such videos from my channel, please do not forget to subscribe it and click on the bell icon and select to get all notifications. And finally, thank you for watching.